Welcome back. In the previous video, we've seen how we can construct and deploy a very simple smart contract to the Ethereum blockchain. This contract, which we have built in the previous video, contained one variable, a string type variable. And in this video, we're going to look a bit farther into variables, and we are going to see the types of variables that can be used in smart contract. And I hope that through the example and the discussion that we are about to have, you will understand the importance of those variables and the proper use of the right type of variable. So let's start with a very basic example. Let's clean our smart contract. We are going to leave this public string, and I'm just going to change the name of the variable so it will be easier to follow. Let's call this one 1, and we are going to assign it this string 1. There we go. The next type of variable that can be used in Solidity is integer. We are going to make this one public as well. We are going to call this one 2, and the value is going to be 2. This is quite obvious. This one is an integer, and therefore it can only contain an integer. And this one is a string, so it can only contain a string. It will not contain integer. So far, it was quite straightforward. And now we have another type of variable, which is called uInteger, or unsigned integer. So let's declare this variable to be public as well. And we're going to name this one 3, and the assigned value will be 3. Now both of those variables, integer and unsigned integer, might seem to do exactly the same. They will both hold integer, but there is one very important difference. The unsigned integer cannot contain any negative numbers. It won't be allowed to hold something like minus 3, only plus 3. Whereas, integer will be allowed to hold negative numbers as well, such as minus 2. So let's see it in action. Let's copy this contract into our Mist wallet. Contracts, deploy a new contract. And over here in the middle, we are going to paste the code and wait for it a minute. And now we can see we can deploy our example contract. No errors, everything works as it should. But if I take this unsigned integer, and I will try to give it a negative value, we will get an error. Once again, unsigned integer will never hold a negative number. So let's remove this minus, and now no errors again. I hope that this kind of example gives you a clue on how important it is to understand the type of variables that can be used in Solidity. Let's think about a very simple example. Let's say that we have some sort of an inventory system that is implemented in a smart contract. And when we are looking in this smart contract, in the way it was written, we can see that the user is allowed to insert a negative values into this inventory system. That really tells me a lot about the type of functionality that is expected from this smart contract. So let us move along with our example, and let's see what other types of variable we can insert. The next type of variable which I want to show you is a private case of this unsigned integer. And this one is called unsigned integer 256. We're going to make this one public as well, and we're going to call this one 4, and it's going to be equal to 4. This variable, number 4, is the same as the unsigned integer in number 3. That means it cannot accept any negative values, but we have predefined the size of this integer to be 256 bits. The Ethereum virtual machine was specifically designed in order to deal with numbers which are 256 bits long. And this decision does have some implications. on the way that we are going to use Ethereum and Solidity. For example, this type of variable can hold the largest amount of Ether, which is accepted by the Ethereum protocol. So if, for example, I am looking at some sort of a smart contract, and I see that in this smart contract, they are making the user to insert a number, an amount of Ether. Maybe it is the amount of Ether they are willing to pay for a specific service. Maybe it is the amount of Ether they wish to take as a loan, or anything like that. And I see that the type of integer that they are asking me, the user, to insert is not this type of integer. It is not unsigned integer, 256 bits. That usually means that either it will not use the full capacity of the Ethereum protocol, or that they might take the variable, which I will insert, do some sort of a computational work on it, and only then store it in this type of variable. And again, this is up to you, but I think that when a contract asks me to specify an amount of Ether, either an amount which I am willing to pay or willing to withdraw, then it is very important to know what is the type of information that it asks me to insert, and to see exactly where this information is stored. And if there are any functions in the middle, that it is always a good thing to be able to follow those functions, because maybe the one who built this contract is not that honest. Maybe he just wants me to insert some sort of an integer, which I believe is the right amount of Ether that I am going to pay for something, but the amount of Ether which will actually be stored in this variable won't be the same. But we don't have to be that suspicious, because if we see that we are asked to insert another variable, it doesn't necessarily mean that the creator of the contract is trying to do some sort of a scam or anything like that. Maybe they just want to create the contract to be somewhat more user-friendly. And that is because this integer is the base unit of Ether. And if you remember from the previous lesson, the base denomination of Ether, which is called WEI, W-E-I, can basically divide one Ether to be 1, followed by 18 zeros. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. This is basically the default way in which the Mist browser and the Mist wallet will ask you to write 1 Ether if you want this 1 Ether to be stored in this type of variable. And so you can see, it isn't that user-friendly. And it is very likely that the owner of this contract, the one who wrote this contract, won't ask you to directly insert this number whenever you want to specify only one Ether. It will ask you to insert a shorter number. Just write 1, or 2, or 3, or 4, and then this number 4 will be converted so it can be properly stored in this type of variable. So once again, it is always important to notice that the best way to maintain a balance, to maintain an amount of Ether, will be to use this type of variable. But it isn't the best, or more likely to say, it is not the most user-friendly way to ask the user to specify that amount. So now we know a little bit more about the type of variables. And I want to talk a little bit about what happened when we try to deploy this type of contract, when we ask the Ethereum network, the Ethereum protocol, to store those variables in the blockchain. Well, as I'm sure you've already know from the previous videos, the Ethereum protocol uses something called gas, gas unit. Those gas units are burned whenever we do a step in Ethereum, whenever we store some variable, whenever we do some sort of a computational work in Ethereum, some gas is burned. The exact amount of gas changes from time to time, And there are a few ways to calculate it, but it's a little bit more advanced, so I'm not really going to go to exactly how to calculate the gas at the moment. But there are a few rules of thumb which are worth knowing about the amount of gas that every steps require and how much ether this step will probably cost. So I'm going to copy this contract and I will take it to my Mist wallet. I will go again to contracts, deploy a new contract, and over here in the middle, I can paste the contract. Let's wait a second for it to compile. Now we're going to pick the contract example. And over here at the bottom, you can see the amount of ether which is expected to be used in order to pay for the deployment of this contract. When I press deploy, I can also see the amount of gas which is expected to be used in order to deploy this contract. Currently, the amount of gas is 236,450 gas units. And as I said earlier, the amount of gas that is burned is proportional to the amount of step, computational work, and storage space that are required by our contract. So let's see an example. If I take this string 1 and I make this variable larger, I will add a few more words into it. Let's say 1, 2, 3. Now we are going to deploy the contract. And you can see that now I am required to pay more gas, 237,730 gas units. And this information also can be quite useful, because when I look at a smart contract, I can always tell that if the smart contract contains variables, then those variables must be very, very important, because the creator of the smart contract have to pay for every variable that it deploys to the blockchain. And it is up to me to make sure that I understand why the creator of this contract think that this variable is so important that it's actually worth to pay for. Now, before I finish up, I want to show you another example, and I want you to think about it for a minute. Remember, over here, we have predefined this unsigned integer to be 256 bits. This is the highest or the largest variable that the Ethereum virtual machine can support natively. Now, what will happen if we will take this unsigned integer 256 and we will reduce its size to be only 8 bits? Well, now we might expect that we will be required to pay less gas because this is now a smaller variable. But let's see what happens now. Now you can see that I'm actually required to pay more gas. I am required to pay 239,081 gas units in order to deploy this contract with this smaller variable. Now it might seem a bit weird, but think about it again for a minute. The Ethereum virtual machine was specifically designed in order to natively support 256 bits integer. So in order to create an integer which is by definition smaller than 256 bits, more steps are required. The Ethereum virtual machine will take this 256 bits variable and it will then split it into smaller parts. So this is also something which I think quite important to notice whenever you look at a smart contract. If the creator of that smart contract chooses to pay more money in order to get less space, that usually means that you have some sort of an agenda. You won't do it just for fun. And it is up to us to understand what is this agenda. Maybe it is a very, very good type of agenda. Maybe you only want to have some sort of a contract that can contain only a very specific type of numbers. You don't want the user to be able to insert any other type of number. But again, it is important to understand that by reducing, by defining a variable to be smaller than 256 bits, we are actually going to pay more money in order to store this variable onto the blockchain. It will not save us any money at all. It will only cost us more. So that was just a small introduction to variables. And in the next video, I will talk with you a little bit more about more variable types. See you then.